Joining me now is royal commentator and host of the To Die For Daily podcast, Kinsey Schofield. Kinsey, it seems every person under the sun is ranting and raving about the new David Beckham documentary on Netflix. The four-part series is giving an inside look at his career, relationship and family. Victoria is obviously a key figure of this documentary, and folks are loving the interaction between the two, including Beck's calling out Victoria when she tries to paint herself as some working class gal.
We're very working class.
Be honest.
What
car did your dad drive you to school in?
So my dad did.
No, one answer.
My dad.
What car was it?
All right, it's not a simple answer
What car did you get your dad to drive?
It depends.
No.
Okay, in the 80s, my dad had a Rolls Royce.
Kinsey, Harry and Meghan could learn a thing or two from Posh and Bex about, well, not playing the victim for one, and actually putting together a documentary or reality series that is worth watching and isn't going to bore the audience silly.
I mean, isn't it fun to watch David hold Victoria accountable? I mean, even in that playful way, it was interesting to see him hold her accountable. But I think that if we are really going to compare, you know, David and Victoria to any members of the royal family, it would be William and Catherine. It's that, you know, that flirtation, that public flirtation, that discretion, that being vulnerable without being a victim. That's what we saw in this, you know, docuseries. And I do think a lot of people turned it on, not expecting to like them more when they were finally done with it. And that's something that Harry and Meghan were not able to accomplish with their docuseries.
Now, Harry's bosses at Netflix have announced that their most controversial and final season of The Crown will premiere on November 16. Harry's Hitler uniform is expected to be a featured storyline. How do you think they will handle this infamous little episode, Kinsey? Harry was obviously very young and silly. Do you think that will go easy on him for what was a youthful mistake?
Well, I do think we typically get worked up about The Crown and then it disappoints us a little bit. Sometimes it's a little bit boring. But with everything, with Israel under attack right now, I do think that the Sussexes need to be I think that they need to act before The Crown has a chance to bring this back up and put this in front of everybody. Again, I think that Harry and Meghan need to be proactive in this case because it's going to anger people. It's become such a heightened, sensitive subject. And Harry needs to face it head on before the world is reminded of it. I think that the Sussexes should be in crisis mode over this particular instance right now, whether that's volunteering with an organization, offering a large sum of money to an organization in support of Israel. I do think that they need to be proactive in this particular case because the Crown could put this on everyone's radar again, and he could see an entirely new generation of individuals angry with him over this thing, you know, and I know he blames Catherine and William, the Prince and Princess of Wales in spare, but nobody bought
that. Well, of course. Well, this is why I really don't want them to make a great deal of fuss about it, because it will just be a case of blaming everybody and playing the victim again. So we'll look forward to that. Now, the fallout of Harry and Meghan's exit from the royal family continues. I've got new claims from a royal biographer, Tom Bauer, who told Daily Express UK that the Duke of Sussex and his wife Meghan Markle have undermined the monarchy and King Charles made a terrible mistake. He says the king should have cut the California-based royals off straight away. He said he should never have allowed their children to be made a prince and princess. Kinsey, I've got to say, I kind of agree with this. It seems the palace was almost bullied into some of these decisions, and you cannot appease people like Harry and Meghan. The more you give, the more they want.
I mean, what are they the prince and princess of? Are they the prince and princess of the Walmart in Santa Barbara, California? They're really not. In America, we don't recognize that. So I think that that idea is silly. I'm going to give King Charles a little sympathy here because I don't want people to forget that Harry and Meghan, despite lying later and saying that it was unconscious bias, they did accuse a mystery member of the royal family of being a racist. That was a horrible period in the palace's existence. And I do think that he risked everybody believing Harry and Meghan's accusations were true by cutting them off and by disassociating with himself with them. There would be people out there that would, you know, see that as translating into, oh, it's true. Everything Harry and Meghan said is true. By being kind, by inviting them to some of these events and still acknowledging them, I think it's made Harry and Meghan look pretty foolish. And so I sympathize with the king here, Rita. Is this the first time in history that we've disagreed?
Well, I got to say, I just think it makes zero sense when you've got two people who have not only slammed the family and the institution, but have declared they're no longer working royals. They're not working royals. So why are their children being given these honours of being a prince and princess? I just think it's rewarding poor behaviour. It's basically being blackmailed into giving these concessions because they're going to make claims of racism. But yeah, you and I do normally agree, so this is unusual. Now, let's get to this latest gripe from Prince Harry. Well, it's not all that new. It was in his autobiography, but we somehow missed it, probably because, you know, we were focused on all that talk about his todger. We missed Beardgate, Kinsey. Yes, whilst we were all focused on his Estee Lauder habit, we missed the bit about the brothers, William and Harry's battle over beards. Let me explain. In the memoir, Harry says he was driven to ask his grandmother, the late Queen, for permission, explaining that the beard made him feel calmer. Yes, she said, you may keep your beard rights, Harry. But then I explained it to my brother and he bristled. Not the done thing, he said. Military rules, so forth. Kinsey, Harry seems to have an excellent recall of every teeny tiny conversation he's ever had with William. This is just, again, another little bizarre extract from the book.
That's perfectly said. It's amazing how he can remember word for word these arguments between him and the Prince of Wales. However, Rita, when you get him on a stand in court under oath, we lose count of how many times he says, I don't know, I don't recall. Do you remember when he was, you know, challenging the tabloids?
Oh, yes.
And he specifically said, what stories, you know, really ruined your childhood? And he's like, oh, I can't remember. So interesting when he picks and chooses when that memory kicks in. But this is just another example of how immature and entitled this young man is. He wants us to believe that Prince William is sitting around devastatingly jealous of him, when in reality, William's a rock star.
Well, he's going to be the king. That's at the end of the day. There's it may not be fair, but he's the firstborn. He's the future king, and Harry was never going to have that honor unless something terrible happened to William. This is an interesting little tidbit there. And he's not a young man anymore, Kinsey. He's what, about 40 now? The fact that he obsesses about these minor details like they matter is interesting in itself. Kinsey Schofield, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you.